Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I would like to now ask again everyone to please find your seats on behalf of Abeeolica, the Brazilian Association of Wind Energy and Geotechnologies. We'd like to welcome you all here today. And once again, I would like you all to take your seats. We'll get started now with a discussion for the 9th meeting of businesses of Abeeolica. And before getting started, I'd like to ask you all to have your phones on silent mode, please. As it was said previously, those that would like to listen to simultaneous translation, please take your headsets at the entrance of the auditorium. During this day, we will have talks and discussions that are essential for the wind industry. According to the agenda, we've already shared with you, and you can see it through the QR codes, as you can see, throughout the auditorium and at the registration desk for the talks and discussions. We will have Abeeolica collaborators with mic, ushering the mic to you if you'd like to add any question. I would like to get started by thanking our sponsors for this edition: the Diamond sponsor, Distribui Logística; Gold sponsor, Equinor and New Energia; Bronze sponsor, AES Brazil; CGN; EDF Renováveis; EDP Renováveis; Elera Renováveis; Enel Green Power; Porto do Açu; Programa de Energia Renováveis Rulim; Lawyers Office and Tecnojar; and the badges Gerdau; and special support GWEC, Global Wind Energy Council. So to get started, I'd like to invite on stage Ms. Elbia Ganum, CEO of Abeeolica and Vice Chair of GWEC. Let's give her a hand, please. I'd like also to invite Mr. Ben Backwell, CEO of GWEC.
Convido também André.
Also, I'd like to invite André Mischiati, Executive Manager of Distribui Logística, for the message of our Diamond sponsor.
Todos podem se acomodar, por gentileza.
Take your seats. And I would like to invite for the welcoming remarks the CEO of Abeeolica and Vice Chair of GWEC, Elbia Ganum. Thank you, Jesse. Good morning. Good morning, everyone. It's great to see you again here at this hotel, unique hotel, for our business meeting now after 2019. This is the first one. And some mentioned to me before getting in the auditorium, wow, it's been so long since I haven't attended. Maybe I was very busy. I said, no, we did not have this event because of the pandemic. And now we're back with this event that we hold at least once a year, sometimes even twice a year. And this event is going through its 10th anniversary this year. And we are definitely making history. We're very happy to be here. This event is full of stars. We have many stars here. And in the morning, the major star with us is the launch of the global report of GWEC. And it's the first time that we launch the global report in Brazil. And we're very happy to be here. And as I talked to Ben in the beginning of this year, He brought this idea, and I said, yes, that's exactly what we'll be doing. You will soon get to know the reason why we are so happy to launch the report, which is the annual report of 2023 in terms of installed capacity of global wind energy. And also, as we do not have in the agenda, there's a star right here on your desks, which or tables, is the info wind, NESG, which is the traditional one, which maybe it's been around for what, 8 years now, and we launched with in Brazil in power last year for the offshore, and now we have one with the info wind, ESG, which is definitely one topic we are proud of addressing, and it's actually the icon of this morning, where we will be talking first about the report. And in the afternoon, we have three interesting panels. The first one about social, and we will have the Vice Minister of Economic and Social Development and a panel with companies, and then we'll have an environmental one. And we will end with a governance panel with former Minister Isabella Teixeira, who is a specialist in the sector in terms of climate, will give us a talk on ESG in the corporate world for the productive sector. So there is definitely much for our day. And definitely, in terms of the report, we will have the right time to address it. And what will I be addressing now then? Well, I'd like to tell you all that we have gone through relevant changes in the global energy industry. And such changes are strongly associated with the climate change and energy transition. From 2019 on, or 2014, I've been taking part of the COP events, and since 2019, it has been more intense for me. And in 2020, which we didn't really have because of the pandemic, but for the last two COP summits, I have been very much involved with my role at GWEC, that has always had a booth at the event and is very involved. And as the vice chair, I've been taking part. And I've realized the extent to which the discussions from 2020 on, which was an important milestone, where the financial market took a deep dive into the discussion of ESG, where the president or CEO of BlackRock wrote that famous letter. So from then on, we realized the incentive of the productive sector to have in the agenda ESG, to have the E and S strong in governance. And I saw interesting moments where the environmental and social are not part of the strategy, but it's actually the strategy itself for companies. And that changes fully the outlook. And that's why we have seen such a shift that is strong. And in that year, we went through a whole oil crisis, a low price and then high price, post-pandemic prices. And that was from 2020 on. We're going through already the third crisis in the oil sector. And this crisis brings us food for thought in terms of the world going or not through the pandemic or the transition, the energy transition after the pandemic because of the crisis. And when I realized that the financial market was establishing strong guidelines, I realized now it's on. And that's exactly what we're seeing. It is taking steps forward, heading towards a defined point, and the speed will be adjusted according to the scenarios. And what scenarios am I talking about? The various crises that we go through, especially the energy one, and the newer is associated to the conflict between Russia and Ukraine, and all the consequences that the crisis come to us in terms of commodities price. So how are we actually heading and paving the path to energy transition and the ESG agenda to be fully at a stronger speed? Because we're talking about environment and social. And when we talk about energy transition, we're talking about fair energy transition, and that's where the social aspect has relevance. And I see that I have many women friends of ours that work hard with us in terms of diversity and inclusion. And as we work with this sector together, we have realized strongly the evolution when it comes to that in the last few years. So yes, we see that and we can realize it, but definitely this type of effect is not understood in a short term, but mid and long term. But we have definitely evolved greatly. And I'm even looking at Laura as I speak, that just launched her wind farm in the state Paraíba. There's ESG in its DNA, right, Laura? So congratulations, which is a hybrid farm, solar and wind farm. So definitely we have been realizing that. And I would like to raise this point associated to another that is of great relevance, which is the one related to politics. Last year we had the elections. We have a new government administration, some change in the Congress. It hasn't fully changed because of the process itself, but once we realize that it's a new government administration, we also are going through a new moment, and we need to take advantage of this opportunity. And we must look into this change in politics so that we can identify the way to work with our agenda, our ESG agenda, but that of energy as well. So in the whole process of change that we've realized globally, the global change itself, we are going through changes in terms of concepts that we haven't realized, but it's important to realize. So I'll bring to you a few words that are key so that you can pay attention to them. First, transition, energy transition, or fair energy transition, no longer just energy transition. And fair means to actually have a transition process that will take into consideration the specifications of each country and each society. And that way, you would have the ESG well established in the process. And the other concept is energy solutions and energy industry. We don't talk about the electric sector anymore. That is not enough. Abroad and in Brazil, we need to bring this concept, and I know that it's not here yet. We keep talking about the Brazilian electric sector, but it's the Brazilian energy sector. And why do I say that? Because we have already been on energy for a long time. And why now, when we bring molecules as green hydrogen, we are talking about the energy sector. When we talk about replacing the Brazilian energy mix to have an energy transition in the Brazilian energy mix, and when we look into specifically the electric grid, we know it's doing quite well. With data from CCE, I can talk here about Alita, Rose, Luis, where the generation of electric energy was over 92% from renewable sources. So this is the energy mix meeting the demand of the electric sector. And now we need to think about energy solutions. So when we talk about auctions and change of methodology of government auction, which is in the agenda, we will be talking about energy solutions and no longer electric energy auctions. And the market is already hiring energy solutions. Laura's farm is an energy solution. It's no longer just an electric solution. But there's another concept that is even broader, and we need to pay attention to it as well. And that is a bit one that is far from our day-to-day, but it must be part of our day-to-day, which is the industrial energy policies. That's what we need to take to the capital city, Brasilia. That's the concept, because we must think about the economy in Brazil based on an energy industry policy in a broader way that is fair, where Brazil is the country with the highest potential to become a global leader in energy solutions to an energy transition, to a fair energy transition. It has the greatest potential, far from any other, but we must transform this potential into reality. And once we have all these concepts in our minds, our work, and as association as well, as we are the advocates for the sector, we're not going to talk about lobby, because lobby has always this idea that it's not positive. So we are the advocates for it. So to be the advocates for the sector, we will not be talking with institutions of the electric sector, but those from the energy sector, and also with those that address social economic development, institutions of science technology development, and we will also talk to the economy ministry. So there is a broader work now where we're going to talk about industry policies based on energy, and we're getting started right now. And since last week and this year, it's been a week now that finally we had the full designations for the Ministry of Mine and Energy. Our agenda will carry on, but it's important for you to understand that you will not see Abeeolica anymore just in the Ministry of Mines and Energy. We will go to the Ministry of Economy, of Development, also to the Ministry of Industry, because we have a broader agenda now where there is a great potential for renewable energy to be able to meet the need of energy. And that's not only for Brazil, it's for around the world. We will replace the energy mix for those industrial consumers where we have a great potential to take that on for the energy transition. And that's what we have to look into. Today, there are many contracts in the segment where we know that the free market is able to sustain itself through that process, but we need to go beyond. And we will be showing some figures, but in terms of the scenario in the short term, we've realized that the market is not doing that well, where we're not hiring. So the motto now is, where is the market? Where is it? Perhaps we must recreate, revisit this market that we can't spot and that is associated to this point related to energy transition and to also the energy solutions, where we will provide renewable energy to the industry that is a producer of commodity that will export green commodity. And in the future, we'll be producing green hydrogen with Brazilian electrolyzers because we already have it to export green hydrogen. We need to think about added value in terms of the industrial concept, and that's why we must understand the energy or industrial energy policy. We're not making this up here for Brazil. The U.S. has just established one with $400 billion in their package, and Europe has just created a new package within the new Green Deal, and now there's another one with 170 billion euros. So everyone is doing, Chile has already, and Brazil will. And how many billions of reais, Elbia? It will be, no, the government does not need to get its hands in the pocket to bring a package of industrial energy policy, but just create what we call a friendly environment to draw investment. That's all we need. And that must be done through regulatory points, through offshore wind, green hydrogen, and also some adjustment for onshore wind energy, and that's what we'll bring to Brazil. And those who have any idea, please come to us because we're going through a whole analysis process. And within this context, we will soon. She's saying that my time is up. Okay, thank you, thank you. I will. So that's what we need to bear in mind, where we need to revisit our concepts. We are with the best business in our hands, where we make renewable energy. It's the best deal in the world, and we're the best people to carry it out. We're ready for it, and we are also very excited. So that's the message I'd like to open this event today and say that perhaps the scenario we have is not the best one, but we are creating a structure so that business can more and more be sustainable, and mainly that we can help Brazil and our planet. And that's why we wake up happy in the morning, because our business is a great one, and we need to remember that we have a great business, which is that of renewable energy. I'd like to also thank, as Marta came up to me saying that I should stop talking, our team, our wonderful team of Abeeolica. There are 24, yes, pretty much. We had 12, now we have 24, so we definitely grew. So I haven't learned all names, but Marta, Felipe, and everyone else in our team coordinated everything for the event, and also our sponsors that were able to make this event a possibility in a short period of time. And thank Ben, for the partnership at GWEC. Here at GWEC, always with us, and now with a partnership for this event. So please enjoy our day. Thank you very much, and I'll see you in a bit with our wonderful figures of our report. Thank you.
Agradecemos pelas palavras.
Thank you very much, Albia, for your kind words. And now we're also going to have Mr. Ben Backwell, the CEO of GWEC, with his opening remarks. Good morning, everyone. Dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends from our industry, I should say, yes, it is very hard to follow Albia, to speak after Albia, because she made a thorough assessment of the global scenario, the challenges we're faced with. There isn't much more left to be said, but I'll make an effort. It's a pleasure. I'm very happy to be back in Brazil. We have been away for a long time because of the pandemic, but I've still had the opportunity to practice my Portuguese with Albia because we have met in different parts of the world. We met in Glasgow and during the COP26. We also met last year in Sharm el Sheikh with the COP27. And this year we will be also meeting in Dubai with COP28. And we've also discussed about the GWEC strategies. We spent 2 days together working in Lisbon, Portugal. We had in-depth discussions about the global energy industry. We met with the GWEC board there. And as usual, Albia made very important contributions. And I would like to say a few words about the report. I don't know if you've noticed, but it's the first time we have an engineer on the cover of the Global Wind Report. Alex, our communications manager, who's sitting at the back of the room. We were trying to find a recent photo of hers and of someone who's actually doing something, not just something from, you know, a photo bank. It's not just a photo, it's more than a photo. Ever since I became CEO of GWEC, we've had the program Women in Wind in place, a leadership program for mentorship for women from across the globe in developing countries, and they match one of them with an executive, a top executive, a CEO, a CFO, a COO from the industry, and this person will mentor this woman for 1 year to actually drive this person to leadership positions in corporations. This year, 100 women have joined the program from different parts of the world, and Albia has also acted as mentor in the program, and it is essential for us to change the industry culture. As Albia mentioned, it's not simply one more technology. This is a discussion that is long in the past. Now we're gone past that, beyond that. We are in a transition. We want to reach a just world for all in terms of energy. Of course, we have the technology, turbines that are huge, and the nacelles and the full system, wonderful. We've made wonderful strides with technology. However, the government, the first thing governments say, whether it's Egypt, Vietnam, Kenya, South Africa, governments, whenever we want to set up a plant, how many plants do you think we can set up? How many jobs will you generate funding? Well, will we obtain funding with ESG conditions? How many women are working in the industry? How many people have been trained, are skilled, and do you have capacity building programs in place? These are the discussions. We're no longer talking about selling turbines anymore. And still, the industry is oftentimes, well, acting as though we're just selling turbines still. When we were smaller, yes, that could be the case. We would say, look, over here, we have this wonderful product, which is low cost, it's clean, high tech, and government authorities would say, well, amazing. Then you would install 2-3 gigawatts, and governments would ask, what's happening in this region? We cannot seem to, you know, supply this market. What is happening here with this transmission module? And after a few years going forward, it seems that government authorities are looking at this thing that seemed wonderful at a first glance as something that could also give them a headache. And this is something we've observed in different parts of the globe. We've reached 20-30% of the market. And at this point in time, we need to start talking about integration with other energy sources. We need to go beyond selling electricity to, you know, auctions, et cetera, to some particular markets. We need to create our own demand. And one of the things we said in Lisbon, in the GWEC meeting, we had a session about oil and gas, right? So this industry is still very successful, is thriving. How do they operate globally? A long time ago, I was a journalist, an analyst in the oil and gas industry. I was working. I remember when Jean-Paul Prates was also in the magazine, in the oil and gas magazine. It was quite something. And it was always about supply and demand. They don't see it as a technology. They don't say, oh, let's dig a well. Let's dig, let's set up a rig. They say, let's set up a rig. Let's refine. You know, we need to set up service stations, petrochemical. It's actually an industry that creates its own demand. And for a very long time, we would simply sell a technology. We would set out to sell a technology, and that was that. And we need, in order to become a key player in the market, we need to go beyond that. GWEC, for example, right now, one of our strategies at the moment is we have made friends with other technologies. We have founded the Global Renewables Alliance. It's a new alliance that we launched in COP27. We're working together with the Global Solar Council, International Solar Alliance, Green Hydrogen Organization, Long Duration Storage Council. These are partnerships for storage. International Hydropower Association. And when we attend COP28 this year, we're not going to simply represent wind energy. We're going to represent the renewables hub. We're also going to bring clients and energy buyers, such as Google, you know, major players, major buyers of energy. And we're coming up with this solution for the energy system and for society by large. And I would also like to mention something Elbia also brought up, the renewable industrial policies, our numbers. The numbers we'll be sharing in the next session show something that is very clear. Starting in 2024, 2025, things are going to accelerate very rapidly. You know, the auction acts are going to be in place. I don't know if in the U.S. players are already considering their orders. They're already setting up new plants in the U.S. Europe also has a renew EU policy now that is accelerating because of, well, Russia's invasion in Ukraine. China is also rebounding. And there are other markets that are also designing their policies, South Korea, Australia, and many others. Our numbers show two different things. First, we're going to see a very rapid acceleration. And by 2025, we'll go to 100 gigawatts in 1 year. with onshore and 25 gigawatts for offshore. That is 125 additional in 1 year. This is a new record, a new time high. 26, 27, and 2028 will be rising further, reaching 170, 180 gigawatts per year and more, aiming for more, because this is according to official requests what we need to do. You saw the ministerial meeting in Copenhagen. Francesco La Camera from ARENA asked for 1 renewable terawatt per year. And I think that will be the way to go. Going forward, if you have twice as much solar than wind energy with a lower capacity, then, well, these renewables, we should be looking into 150 gigawatts for wind energy annually. I think that's quite realistic. And along these lines, I would say there's a global industry that, is there a global industry in place to supply all of these numbers? Not really. We are at this point in time, we have 160 gigawatts in capacity with RNSLs. And as you all know, this is not all. We need to consider overcapacity because you have sometimes different regimens and bottlenecks in certain regions. And right now we don't really have a surplus of capacity. When the United States and China accelerating and Europe, we are not going to we're not going to be able to sit and wait. We need to continue growing year over year. And the numbers indicate that Europe and the US are going to face a shortage of equipment in 2026. By looking at the existing capacity, this is the outlook. And in terms of Brazil, we should also consider this outlook, looking at the Brazilian energy market, energy industry, and the manufacturing or production capacity available in Brazil to become a global giant in energy transition with all the resources in Brazil, with the 15-year successful trajectory, with people like all of you sitting here in this room with the capacity, the skills, the experience. You have so much creativity here in Brazil. You have a will to innovate, and you have a serious regulatory framework. And of course, we need to consider these broader horizons, new perspectives, looking at the auctions and the domestic market and the accelerated growth and the great potential that Brazil has been creating that will remain in place. And if Brazil considers the onshore growth, hybrid farms, hydrogen, ammonia, the exports opportunities, because we should be candid, yes, exports are not big so far, and with this well-expected integration in Latin America, something we will all welcome, and Colombia and Chile and Argentina one day, etc., so on and so forth, Brazil has the industrial scale to play a key role in energy transition among these countries. And for all of these reasons, we've decided to launch the report here in Brazil, of course, to give our support to Brazil in this important transition period. We're also very grateful because it's not just a sign of support to the market, it's a very important role for Abeeolica, who has been collaborating very closely with GWEC. Abeeolica plays a very important role globally, and this is an opportunity to see Brazil at the forefront, and Abeeolica and LBI is telling the story among different stakeholders, and we want to continue sharing the story globally. We firmly believe in Brazil, and we believe these 10 years going forward will be an extremely important period for all of us. Thank you.
Agradecemos pelas palavras do senhor.
Thank you for your words. And now we'd like to invite the executive manager of Distribui Logística, André Mesquiato. I'd like to thank Mr. Ben Backwell. Good morning, everyone. After CEO Elbia and CEO Ben talk, it's hard to address anything, but I would like to bring some food for thought on a specific agenda. Within this whole understanding, it's important to realize what other organizations within the renewable energy chain is doing and contributing to meet the environment, social, economic indicators, especially logistics and transportation, which are areas that represent an important factor in environment. So Distribui Logística, founded in the year 2000, is turning 23 now in March, has been working as a specialist in the energy sector, working with low cargo storage and transportation of heavy and light cargo. And as it's specialized in wind, it has been also seeking a way to contribute. What can we do to meet the demands of the major players that have strict guidelines and targets sent to us? Distribui in 2018 started a program, a very simple one, so that we could learn all about our capacity of pollutants within our organization. And this evolved over the years, and now in 2022, we reached a result that is very positive. We reduced in 5% the level of pollutants. Are we satisfied? Yes, we definitely are, but this is not it. We are with a very aggressive goal until 2030 to reduce 65% of pollutants within our organization. And this is possible through embedded technology, development of our team, acquisition of equipment with electric engine, natural gas engine, and the use of green diesel. So Distribui has attempted to contribute and evolve in the process so that we can have a better world. So Elbia and Ben, you are not alone in this whole world out there. So to complete, I'd like to bring a thought of Ibauna, who says that faith is not what we see, but it is to create what we do not see. And that's exactly where we're working on, and you are as well. And this is what we are based on. So we must to create what we still do not see. Thank you very much, and good morning.
Agradecemos a participação do senhor André.
Thank you very much for your participation. I'd like to ask you all three to stand up for our official photo for this opening session. And right after that, CEO Albia Ganum will be handing to Mr. André the gift, thanking him for the participation. So once again, let's give them all a hand. And please, we will have on stage Albia Ganum and Ben Backwell, and Mr. André Mischiati will be back to seat. And now, after the opening session, we will have now the launch of GWEC's Global Wind Report 2023 for the first time in Brazil. So again, we have Ben Backwell and Albia Ganum together for the presentation of the main figures and rank of 2023.
Desculpa, que estou vendo onde eu vou.
Let me see where I'll be watching the screen. As I age, I am becoming more and more nearsighted. So anyway, let me show you the figures. I don't want to bring too many numbers to you. And I have to say that we got very excited to be here in Brazil this week, and how GWEC's team has been excited. And we had a party at the penthouse here at the pool. And I think we spent more time there than we should have. But I'll be showing you the numbers in any case. So first of all, it was a great year for the wind energy. Actually, it wasn't. It was a big year, but we've been at this little level since 2020. And we see one that shows the new normal for the industry, where it was a constant step forward when we knew that 1 megawatt per year was much, and now this is where we're at, of 100 gigawatts. And 2020 was a record year, and 2021 was the second one, where last year was lower. And why? Because the industry is adjusting to new reality, where prices and projects are not what you had from 3 years ago. Some people took a step back to absorb inflation, the high cost of raw material of steel, copper, cement. And in Europe, they had issues administratively for the licensing. And in the US, many companies were expecting to get the Inflation Reduction Act that is still being implemented by the government there. So when we get to 2023, we'll start to see the bounce back of the market. In 2023, we already know from our members that they're strongly back at a strong pace in the US, China, and other parts around the world. And many new countries also starting to work with this. And this shows that it wasn't a great year for the US, and in China, they had the adjustment of the tariffs. So definitely not a very good year, but a year of transition. But who is on wind energy around the world? China 47%. Sometimes they're 40, 42. Last year was 47% of the whole market. If it weren't for China, the market wouldn't have grown at all. That is the driver, and there's no sign of stopping. Actually, they'll speed up. They're already on offshore at a strong pace. Just so you can fathom, there's a city in Guangdong province in China where they have an offshore wind farm of 5 gigawatts. It's the size of the whole electric grid in Norway. So there is an industrial plan to have the factories in the same region for supply. There is the installation of the whole grid for the city. There's a plan of green hydrogen inside the master plant. All is thought of in the long run. Something that we can see, Brazil, that has an important role, 6% of the global market, the U.S. with 13, and this will grow in the U.S. And for offshore, it was a regular year. It wasn't a big year as we had in the year before that. But it is a trend of growing, and we believe that offshore wind will reach 25 or 30% of the total market. And what we have seen for the next years is the following, and I'll explain the methodology here as well. These are current policies of government administrations that already have been implemented, and this is the pipeline that members tell us is already with contracts underway. And this is a business as usual, where it's pretty much what is under construction and what has been contemplated within the policies that have been implemented. And we see this growth reaching 160 gigawatts per year. That will be the new normal. And then we see that every year we're going to have over 150, 160 gigawatts per year, which is quite significant. We have a bit under 100 now, so we'll have 160 per year. If we do as governments tell us to, which is basically what is being contemplated in net zero by 2050, which is a scenario of the international agency, and the transitions outlook also has that, where both have wind energy as the main source of electricity, not installed capacity, but as a production. It will be definitely the major source by 2050. Wind is 8 terawatts by 2050. What's interesting to realize here is that this year we'll reach 1, and it took us 40 years to get there. And the next one will have it in 8 years. So, I mean, if you pay attention to the figures, by 2030, 31, we'll already be at 2 terabytes just because of this growth. This is the pace we see. And mainly because of these plans you see in Europe, US, and China. And I believe there is much more than business as usual. This is when we, I mean, just look into what has already been in contract, but government administrations will have to speed up the policies to be able to reach net zero. Otherwise, I mean, if you have, IEA has said that you need to have 380 gigawatts per year by the end of this decade. In 2030, we should already have 380 per year. And I would like to see us reach that with wind energy. And every time We are in meetings explaining that they sometimes are not heading the right way. And right here, it shows exactly what I was talking about. The gray is net zero, and blue is where is our territory today, where you can tell that there is quite a gap where there needs to be some effort to reach a 1.5 degrees for net zero. So I believe we will get somewhere in between there, midway, I would say. I'm not sure we will get all the way to the target there, but I believe, I mean, there is no industry in the world that has the opportunity we have ahead of us. Now let's see this point that I addressed in my introduction about the supply chain. Where is today the whole industrial capacity? It's in China. So 19% is in Europe, 9% the US. So it's not much, because many Latin American actually companies are in China, and that has been changing. And Latin America is 4%, which is mainly Brazil, and to some plants in Argentina, with some assembly plants in Argentina, some in Mexico. The Mexicans also have one plant there, but mainly is Brazil. Well, as we know, we'll get to this goal, 160 gigawatts, and we know that there is no cap necessarily. You need to have a different type of cap depending on each market, but usually we work on 20 to 30% of extra capacity. And now, this is some analysis that we went through at GWEC, where we mapped all the plants around the world, and the companies contributed, where we had this whole movement, where we compiled all the information from manufacturers, and we added the data with the full confidentiality needed. And here you can see by 2025 for onshore, Europe and the US already will have a lack of turbines just with this territory that we are working on now, where the rest of the world, because there are new markets, will also. So there is a lack already. So companies are already building new plants, and we already have some MOUs in the US, Korea, where there are some new plants to be built. Is it at the pace necessary so we can avoid this scenario? Nope, not for now. And this is a consequence of the industrial policy that is bad. I need to use this word because the world has realized that in the last few years. Well, it's very notorious that the major manufacturers around the world have been losing money, especially in a moment where we need to have them invest more. I mean, it's definitely a paradox. I think IEA calls this a bizarre paradox, as they call it, where exactly when you need to go through the energy transition, the companies that invest on such transition will not make money. That situation will have to change, and many actions to be taken by government administration. We see with the Inflation Reduction Act in the US to be able to deal with this situation. I mean, we have MOUs for new plants. There are many in the US at the East Coast for offshore. We have GE, Siemens, it's all public information, that are already planning to start new plants. And the U.S. does not have now capacity to add to it. And that's for onshore. And for offshore, we have a similar situation. By 2026, we'll have a lack of turbines in Europe and the U.S. By 2025, that's when the big offshore plants will start to be built, which already went through the bidding process. And now they'll get into a construction. And the U.S. does not have a offshore industry, and they'll need to. And it's not just the nacelles and all that comes with it, but the ships and all the converters, the boxes, the towers. And we saw here a situation with the nacelles, but that's the easiest part, I would say. Because to have a plant of nacelle, it's a big warehouse, huge with the specialized labor to assemble the components in the nacelle. But what comes with it? This is for the blades. China, 60%, excuse me, Europe, 14%, US 7, we see India 11%, LATAM 7 mostly is Brazil. Now check generators, where we have 65% China, India a bit more, the US pretty much nothing because they manufacture in China for the American market. And the gearbox. What do you call that gearbox? Okay. Well, the U.S. did not manufacture a gearbox. I mean, this must change. 75% of gearbox manufactured in China. Will this change overnight? No. China will have an important role there. But will they keep having 75%? I don't think so, because the industrial policy is in Europe, in the U.S. So there is a demand of having a rebalance of the supply chain, so there isn't such a dependence on China. And this will not be an easy task. I mean, we're talking about an industry that has reached a high scalability and a whole chain behind it, so it's not an easy one. This is interesting because these are the ships where the vessels that you need to have the offshore installation. And to simplify, we believe that at this point, the last generation turbines, you have four vessels globally that can have that for the 15 megawatt turbine, four vessels. One is under construction, but you'll need much more. And you need to have local control. You can't just have like a Chinese ship in the US or in Taiwan. Most likely you'll not be able to use a Chinese vessel in Korea or Japan either. And the US has Jones Act, where you must use vessels constructed in the US. And I believe that will bring a hard situation where there will need to have flexibility to the legislation, or you'll need to have an acceleration of the production of these vessels. Well, this is what I mainly want to say. Brazil has a great opportunity here. If Brazil thinks beyond the Brazilian domestic market, Brazil has quite an opportunity in the Americas, in the US, where there will be complexity of negotiation with the US. that is within the Inflation Reluctant Act, and that's something they're already negotiating. And in Europe, with the batteries and with the electric vehicles, the U.S. will not have capacity to have that with the Inflation Reluctant Act. So there is quite an opportunity that is automatic for Brazil. And I believe that within the continent as well, there will be an opportunity. But Brazil's industry must be up to date producing last generation turbines, and they need to have scalability to export in a competitive manner. And for me, must be very serious on the offshore market. It's not a matter of thinking that offshore we don't need because we already have onshore and other energy. We need to look into the future. And to position yourself into the future, you need to start right now to have that position well established within 10 years. So I strongly believe that it's an industrial policy to be established in Brazil that is important. So these are the figures that I wanted to show you. I didn't want to show anything very complex. So we have here the major information where I'd like you also to download the report to get the breakdown of the numbers. But my conclusion is basically that because supply chain will definitely be the main topic for government administrations and the industry for the next 5 to 10 years at the COP summit that will be discussed. And there are opportunities out there. I'll leave it at that so you don't get too mind-boggled with figures. And we will keep discussing about the situation.
Obrigada, Ben.
Thank you, Ben. And now, well, the easiest and, happiest part is up for me to take now. As Ben just showed, with the global numbers, there has been a reduction, a downturn caused by the pandemic. We're talking about the infrastructure industry and the effects of the pandemic actually hit us and will continue hitting us for 1, 2, 3 years. And Ben also pointed out the global scenario with the end of the packages in China and the US, the renewables package they had in the US, which actually makes us think and understand why this industry is so complex. It is complex by definition because, you know, of the kind of turbines and equipment that are used in many countries. It is highly dependent on policies, on packages. And when we look at Brazil, there's a very interesting point. Brazil actually surpassed the installation mark last year, 4 gigawatts, 4.2 gigawatts to be precise, of installed capacity. This is the second consecutive record because in 2021 we installed 3.8 gigawatts. Brazil did not feel the effects of the pandemic. It continued to grow regardless, and the wind energy in Brazil is growing exponentially ever since the first auction. It has a very strong growing trend with the potential to continue right on track. However, there are short-term factors we need to look at closely, as I also mentioned earlier. Why did this industry continue growing? I remember very well the tipping point was back in 2017. We didn't have an auction in 2016, a year before that. We actually sold, I think, lower power, 1.6 gigawatts. And so far, we would sell only in the regulated market. But as of 2018, we began to sell energy in the free market. And the average annual growth, that was our break-even point, was 2 gigawatts a year after 2018. We started selling 4 gigawatt a year. We doubled, therefore, our figures. And we continued on the same trajectory ever since. And therefore, in 2021 and 22, we saw the result. But Albia, when are we feeling the effects of the result? We won't be feeling that because the free market actually was a buffer, but we will feel the impact regardless of the positive numbers, with a record in terms of installation in Brazil, whereas Latin America actually reduced their investments in new onshore wind installations, and the same continued around the world. But Brazil was different, and it's the third economy with the highest wind installation rates in the world, and the country ranks sixth in installed capacity. What will happen going forward? Looking at the data regarding this outlook, last year a company that produced manufactured turbines left Brazil, GE left Brazil, and this year we also heard Gamesa will actually stop their production for 6 months because there are no orders coming in. Here's the paradox. I think the international agency, the IEA, actually said, how can it be that we're in the middle of an energy transition? We need to install more renewables and the numbers are dropping. How can that be the case? So these are relevant national characteristics we have in Brazil because the free market actually controlled the industry's capacity to sell, and the free market corresponds to up to 80% of our market. And I see Carla and her team. We also work together to create a nationalization policy, so 85% of our turbines are produced here locally, which makes us strong. But having one or two players leaving Brazil is concerning. What is going to happen to our industry going forward? Also, an important thing that happened in 2018, we were here at this hotel, Unique, when we launched the funding design that was created by the BNDES for the free market. This was the foundation. That's why we leapfrogged to the free market. We had the funding policy and the possibility to migrate to the free market. The funding policy is still in place and doing well. Thank you. Of course, if interest rates can go down, that will be excellent, right, Carla? But yes, we have a funding policy, but this opening speed will go down gradually, and it's therefore important to continue driving this market forward, the free market forward, to make it solid. And there are other factors that are related to the global outlook, such as the pressure on commodities. So people say, Elba is always so optimistic, so positive, the market is growing. No, I'm realistic. But if I have good news, well, don't blame it on me. Now, yes, Elbia's realism is sharing the following with you today. Amazing, amazing figures, but the question is, where's the market? So we have to think closely about our market. And we can also mention other factors that are also related to what I said earlier. It was not by chance, which is the following. Right now in our industry, and this year with the low PLD, we are not hiring in the free market, yes, using the free market alone. So what will happen 2-3 years from now, when in theory the plant will be ready? I don't know what these numbers will look like. This is a question mark here. It's a question without an answer for now. Why is this happening? On one hand, in the Brazilian economy, we have a non-satisfactory growth for 10 years now. The GDP is not growing. The ACR is not hiring because it will always be tied to the GDP. We're only growing thanks to the free market. that we operate in and will continue to operate in. But what is the size of the free market? That is the question. We are running a study at Abeeolica to try and understand the size and the capabilities of the free market. But yes, the market is a little bit sluggish for a reason. If you look at the supply chain, you also identify similar problems. Now, on the other hand, if you wish to buy a turbine today to receive it 2 years from now, you won't find it. So that's a funny paradox, because whereas some plants are no longer operating, you want, on the other hand, to buy a turbine. You can't find them. You've never sold so much energy. There are many different variables that we need to take into account, and this is the outlook right now. And Ben just mentioned how much investment the world has to make in renewables, and the numbers I shared about the U.S. packages, the European packages, the EU packages, and the relevant role China plays in growth, not only in terms of installation, but also supply chain. Well, in the mid and long run, we will have actually a rebound of investments in renewables, a virtuous rebound. The market is there, the potential is there, the industry's capacity is not really there. We need to change that around, and these packages are key because they will attract investments, and these will be sustainable, continued investments. We will not attain the just, fair energy transition without the strong and solid role of the state. It does not mean to say the state has to disperse funding, but it will all depend on every economy, every region, but public policy needs to take the lead. Otherwise, we will see a common thing among economists, which is the stop and go movement. And this industry cannot afford to have a stop and go approach. You cannot shut down a plant and then reopen it. And in Brazil, yes, we need to have policies in place. We have, and now once again looking at Laura, back at the Ministry of Mines and Energy in the Prime Fund 2003, we actually created a policy. We set up a policy. We created a stable regulatory framework. We attracted investments, but this industry grew in Brazil without a structured policy. We had sectorial policies from the BNDES, which is great. We had, of course, regulations for the sector, which were very important. However, Brazil lacks an overarching policy. I do not mean subsidies, by no means. I mean public policy, education, and actions. Why do we need to focus on public policy to sustain an industry that we have built ourselves and very skillfully, I should say, but we need to have continued growth, sustainability, and also to have sustainability for this new industry, offshore wind and hydrogen. And people sometimes ask me, tell me, no, but you're talking about onshore, you have 800 gigawatts and onshore. Why onshore? It's so costly. I told Raisa in the auction, 45 euros per offshore energy unit. Is it really that expensive? 45 euro? Well, it makes me stop and think. But the most interesting thing I've heard lately is the future is being decided right now. We do need to work out a regulatory framework for offshore right now. I'm really anguished. I think we might lose track of things. We need to have a new policy in place immediately, because we need to consider the auction for offshore areas that will be used later on. And we need to consider the assignments, the transfer. This takes time. 2027, I think we'll begin to install the first offshore wind farm in Brazil. Until then, the offshore price will have gone down, will have dropped. Onshore was 6 times the price of hydropower energy back at the time. It became the second cheapest country energy in the country. And in 2015, solar was twice as much as wind power. And today, it's cheaper than wind energy. And this is how everything works. We, you know, we need to focus on policy in the mid and long run, not the short run. And this is what we have in our agenda. We need to look at the potential we have and look at the future as well. Because I am really tired of saying that Brazil can become a global leader of renewable energies. But I've been saying this for 3 years now. I don't want to keep talking, and you know, we need to walk the talk. Otherwise, others will take the lead, and this is the time we need to do it now. Helbia, there's no demand for offshore. Yes, there is. Just look at this chart, 71. Projects, 107 gigawatt in these projects, and licensing process. This is the offshore demand that we have, especially, well, there are oil and gas companies that are making the energy transition, and they need to look at their projects, and they need to have access to lease areas that are offshore areas. And after the PRISM auction, you'll consider the power auction or not, because you have the free market. So let us begin with the PRISM market, and then we'll consider the power auction. This is what we need to do. There are no hydrogen off-takers. Oh, not now, but the plants are coming in, and they're huge, and they will require a huge amount of energy. And the opportunity is right here, right now. We cannot miss out on it. We have to really be clear on that and to keep an eye on this industry. This is a very keen tipping point in the global energy industry, because we have the just energy transition that is in full swing. Brazil is the country with the best position to go through this process without disbursing any funding. Let us do it together. Thank you.
Cortaram meu microfone, vocês estão me ouvindo? Agora sim, né? Mais ou menos.
Bem, opa, agora sim.
Okay, now it's working. So once again, thank you, Elbia Gano and Ben Backwell. And we would like to have an official photo of both of you together, please.
Como dito, agradecemos mais uma vez a apresentação do...
Once again, thank you for presenting the report, and now both will head to the press conference with our journalist at the Kia room to my left of the auditorium. And everybody else here, please, let's remain here for the talk with Fernando Gacchini Lopes from the Instituto Totem about certifications of renewable energy with ESG strategy. So here with us, Fernando, director of the Totem Institute.